With the introduction of the space shuttle program, NASA began accepting women for the first time for astronaut training in 1978. And six American female astronauts began training to fly into space. The length of time between the first American man and the first American woman in space was 23 years. The 1978 astronaut training class included Anna Fisher, Shannon Lucid, Ray Seddon, Kathy Sullivan, Judy Resnick, and Sally Ride. NASA recognized that military test pilot experience was not a necessary requirement for astronaut training, and so emphasis shifted to advanced academic achievement with a minimum doctoral-level degree in medicine, engineering, or natural sciences. These women held doctoral degrees in electrical engineering, physics, medicine, chemistry, biochemistry, and geology. They were engineers, commercial pilots, oceanographers, and medical doctors. From the first group of six female American astronauts, Sally Ride became the first American woman in space. Kathy Sullivan became the first American woman to walk in space. Shannon Lucid was the first American woman to fly on a space station, Mir, and hold the most flight hours in orbit by any woman in the world. We also found Judy Resnick, the first American woman to die on her way to space when the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded shortly after takeoff, January 28, 1986. They all started by submitting their application to the astronaut program. All applicants must be American citizens, less than 35 years of age, and have a standing height of between 62 and 75 inches. They must pass the NASA Long Duration Spaceflight Physical. Astronaut training for the space shuttle took place at the Johnson Space Center in the FFT, or Full Fuselage Trainer. This entailed 20 separate courses and up to 100 hours of training. The first 2 years of training was mostly in the classroom, where the astronauts were instructed in the engineering systems of the space shuttle, including spacecraft propulsion, thermal control, and life support systems. In addition, they received training in orbital mechanics, scientific experimentation, earth sciences, meteorology, space science, engineering, and astronomy. From the class of 1990, Eileen Collins became the first woman to pilot, command, and land the space shuttle. Pilot astronauts were required to fly a modified Gulfstream jet aircraft and fly more than 1,000 approaches in this aircraft before ever landing the shuttle. Also from the class of 1990 was Susan Helms, a veteran of 5 shuttle flights, holding the world record of continuous spacewalk time of 8 hours 56 minutes. Each trainee must be proficient in all activities related to pre-launch, launch, orbit, entry, and landing. They prepare for events that might pose a hazard to theirs and the crew's health, including failure of a critical life support system, capsule depressurization, fire, and other life-threatening events. Outside the classroom, astronauts are required to pass the military water and land survival training. They must swim 3 lengths of a 25-meter pool without stopping, and then swim 3 lengths of the pool in a flight suit and tennis shoes. They must also tread water continuously for 10 minutes while wearing a flight suit. They must become scuba qualified. Astronaut candidates are required to train at the Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory, NBL, a deep water pool where training includes spending approximately 10 hours underwater for every hour they will spend walking in space. After passing the first phase of training, the astronauts then enter the Advanced Mission Training Phase, where they focus on activities specific to their mission, which might include specific satellite launches or scientific experiments. Between 1978 and 1999, women aboard the space shuttle deployed the Hubble telescope, communication, and other satellites. They captured satellites and repaired them. They launched the Galileo Jupiter spacecraft. They conducted numerous scientific experiments, including life sciences, Earth radiation monitoring, metal alloys, solar arrays, and orbital refueling systems. They tested and helped perfect the cargo bay manipulator arm. And they performed the first docking with the Russian space station Mir. Women performing EVAs or spacewalks provided valuable experience, which led to improvements in spacesuit design, maneuvering systems, and physical science, which helped lead the way to untethered EVAs. Women have been a leading and integral part in the advancement of human space travel. Ever mindful of the risky nature of space travel, from the class of 1995 and 1996, Dr. Kalpana Chawla and Dr. Laurel Clark lost their lives when the Shuttle Columbia broke apart during re-entry, February 1st, 2003. In 1999, a new era in space exploration began when construction was started on the International Space Station. Women continued to play a vital role in space along with the construction and development of the ISS. With the construction of the ISS, the space shuttle took on a different role, and astronauts were required to receive training for the ISS in addition to their basic training. At the Johnson Space Center, the Space Station Mock-up and Training Facility, or SSMTF, is a full-scale replica of the International Space Station. For missions aboard the ISS, each astronaut is required to become proficient at 100 or more experiments. Advanced training includes a much more in-depth look into the ISS, including learning how to service and operate all systems. Enhanced science training is also implemented to ensure all astronauts can perform science experiments on board the ISS. This phase takes about 1 year to complete, at which time the astronaut is assigned to a flight. Currently, a 6-month mission to the ISS requires up to 5 years of astronaut training. After a 6-month tour of duty aboard the ISS, Peggy Whitson became the first woman commander of the International Space Station in April 2008. Currently, astronauts are only trained to fly in the Russian Soyuz spacecraft and live on board the ISS. After the shuttle retired, Soyuz became the only mode of transportation to the International Space Station. Additional training, therefore, is now required of astronauts, which includes 1 year training at Star City in Russia, where astronauts must also take Russian language lessons. It may be possible that the ISS will be used as a long-duration astronaut training facility in the future. Another powerful astronaut training tool is NASA's Extreme Environment Missions Operations, NEMO, a 40-foot habitation tube anchored in 65 feet of water located off the coast of Florida. Here, astronauts, including women, are training for long, deep space missions. With the end of the space shuttle era, and since astronauts are selected on an as-needed basis, fewer flight opportunities are now available for women, and that number is expected to decline further. Perhaps one day humans will return to the moon, land on an asteroid, or Mars. Perhaps one day, when humans take their first step on the surface of Mars, we will hear the words, "That's one small step for a woman."
The memories to me are as if it were yesterday. When the space shuttle's engines cut off and you're finally in space, in orbit, and weightless. And then I remember unstrapping from my seat, floating over the window, and that's when I got my first view of Earth. Just a spectacular view and a chance to see our planet as a planet, which very few people have the opportunity to do. I remember the first time that I looked towards the horizon, I saw the blackness of space and then this bright blue earth. And then I noticed right along the horizon, it looked as if someone had taken a royal blue crayon and just traced along Earth's horizon. And then I realized that that blue line, that really thin royal blue line, was Earth's atmosphere. And that was all there was of it.